Good evening, everybody. Welcome to our 5 o'clock broadcast of the 2015 U.S. Open of Curling, coming to you from the Four Seasons Curling Club at Fogarty Arena in Blaine, Minnesota. My name is Sean Murray, and joining me tonight is special guest Mr. Curling Zone himself, Jerry Gertz. And Jerry, we are going to be covering a treat of a matchup tonight, and it's going to feature two of the best teams in Manitoba, and for that matter, the best teams in Canada. This is Jeff Stoughton versus Reid Carruthers.
Thanks, Sean. Thanks very much for the opportunity to come join this great TESN broadcast. Joe Calabrese and Brian Anderson doing a wonderful job, and the fans, I think, really love to see this. We've got Team Carruthers here, lead Colin Hodgson, second Derek Samogalski, at third Braden Moskowy, and the skip Reid Carruthers. Carruthers 4-0 thus far, wins over Dunham, Bono, Clark, and Craig Brown.
Yeah, they've had a really strong start, and going up against a very familiar face, Jeff Stoughton. Stoughton has a new team this year. He's got an old teammate, Rob Fowler, playing third for him, but he's got a new, relatively young front end. Are you familiar with the guys playing front end for Stoughton?
Yeah, Connor Negevin and Alex Forrest, I think. When you look at Stoughton's team, there's been a lot of inconsistency all year, and you see those results here as well. A loss to Bono to open this up. And 2-2 record coming into this game. A must win for Team Stoughton. Carruthers 4-0, they've booked their playoff spot right now, it looks like, as well. So not as much on the line for Carruthers, but definitely a lot of pride between these two teams.
Absolutely. Reid and Jeff were teammates for several years, won a Brier and a World Championship together in 2011, I believe it was.
That's correct. And I think by the end of it, I think the comments were, I think everybody was ready to move on from that lineup.
Yeah.
Stoughton was interviewed during Grand Slam. They did a rock talk, and he basically said nobody wanted to curl with me next year.
Kind
of Meade went to join with Glenn Howard, and Mark Nichols went back to Newfoundland, and Reid Carruthers was ready to be back in the house again. He's been a skip for most of his career, and prior to joining Jeff, he had skipped several different teams in Manitoba. Mm-hmm. So lost a provincial final going back to something like 2007, 2008.
Somewhere around there, yeah.
To Jeff when he was skipping, Jason Gunnlaugsson was third, and that exciting team that they had together at that point.
So, no surprise, some early rocks in play. Jeff establishes the center guard. The come around goes a little bit deep. Reid freezes, and then Colin Hodgson comes on top. So, we're going to get some rocks in play right from the start here. No real surprise.
One interesting thing when you look at these two teams, Carruthers is probably the better rated team this year, had more success. And rates a little higher on the order of merit. But Jeff is actually 3-1 this year against Reid. So there's still that little bit of veteran presence. He knows how to get the wins against against Reid.
Yep. In terms of ranking, Reid Carruthers is currently ranked 9th in the world on the two-year order of merit, and Stoughton is not far back at 15th.
Seeing a name like Stoughton that far back, though, that low on the order of merit is very rare. For quite some time now, Stoughton has typically been a top five team in the order of merit. So,
yes.
It's a little different dynamic, and Jeff's put this team together. At this point, it's not necessarily a four-year run at the Olympics.
Right.
It's a matter of, he wants to curl another year, and he's taking it year by year at this point.
Right, exactly. Derek Samogalski, tasked with the run back, kills most rocks. Gets that one to just barely spin off the house, I think. Leaves Stoughton line one buried, but just behind the tee line. Without the hammer, he's content to throw another tight center.
Whoa, 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 yep! Whoa, yep, yep!
just for our fans at home, Mr. Murray is correct with the hammer here. The indicator is on Stoughton at the top. Just a little bug in the graphics system. Carruthers with the hammer here in the first end.
Sweepers hard to get this by, and they get it by just into the top 12. It peeks out the other side a little bit, but I think Reed's going to, Derek, play another run back. Hopefully clip that one off the forefoot. Curls just misses everything in the house. They're possibly a little bit tight on that. You're not going to see a rock moving that fast curl quite that much, so maybe got that one going just a little bit.
The tough spot there, he does leave his own center guard up in play. He's going to keep congesting that middle, and Stoughton may be able to throw a second guard up here now.
Yeah, that rock is a little bit in the way of a potential draw on the outturn side if you're a right-hander. This is our first look at Rob Fowler. Skipped his own team for a couple of years. We've won a Manitoba Provincial in 2012, I think, and defeated Jeff Stoughton along the way.
Manitoba's always been one of the toughest provinces to qualify for the Brier out of. And, you know, you look at the success that Stoughton has had, 11 provincial titles. It's almost impossible to imagine somebody could have won it that many times.
I'm quite certain that's a record, and I can only imagine how long that record's going to stand in Manitoba. It could be a very long time before anybody gets close to that.
Well, there is a pretty good young team by the name of Mike McEwen. I think it's going to be the case that once they win their first, and I think the question is more when rather than if.
Right.
I think they've got the skill set to string off many in a row.
Yes, they do.
You know, I think Reed's team, it'll be interesting to see where Reed stacks up against McEwen in playdowns. And, you know, with first year together as a team and a little bit of a different skill set, you look at Reed, they bring a good hitting game, but they've got a strong touch game as well.
Yes.
Reed is a very good draw player, has good feel out there. So, you know, I think it's a good difference in dynamic out on the ice, where most Manitoba teams are typically your
just hit.
Yeah, go to the hit first, run them up and down the sheet. You know, make, you know, when you want to get out of trouble, you make the hit first, and that's been Stoughton's bread and butter forever. And McEwen's team, that's definitely what you see as their strength as well.
Right. So Manitoba will be interesting this year with these two teams in the ice and McEwen, and probably have some saying that McEwen is due to finally win a Manitoba title and get his first trip to the Brier. He's been so close so many times and has actually faced Stoughton several times in the past few years and never quite seems to get past him. But people are asking, maybe this is the year Stoughton. McEwen's had an incredible season.
I think when you look at McEwen losing in those years, it's not necessarily a case where, you know, he was the outright favorite to win, though, either.
Right.
Because Stoughton, even those years when, you know, the last three or four years, Stoughton has been a top, as high as top two or three on the order of merit, and inside the top five for the most part.
Sure.
So, you know, it's not like McEwen lost to,
well, right.
A bunch of slouches out there. Either,
exactly.
So.
Exactly.
That's always the hard part when you look at an event like that, where only one of the top teams get to go. And you're going to see that change in Canada this year with Team Canada. First year Team Canada will be in the Brier.
Yep.
And you'll see the opportunity. You'll have two Alberta teams in Brier this year with the Morris former Cooey foursome that won last year. And now, you know, the favorite to probably come out of Alberta is Cooey with his new squad.
I would think so.
Cooey yeah, I'd the, rather nose it.
Former Kevin Martin teammates.
I don't want to hit this one at all.
Mark Kennedy and Ben Ebert. And also Brent Lang throwing second rocks.
Yeah. And it's, you know, it opens the door for other teams. You know, you got another good young team in Alberta that's actually here, Mick Lismore. They've had a very strong season. They've qualified directly to the provincials, and probably the reason they're here, so they have some games to play before they get ready for provincials. And then, of course, Brendan Botcher's team, who's played really well in the Grand Slams.
Yeah, he's really showed up this year.
Yeah, and both those teams, you know, with one less team, you know, with Team Canada at the Brier, you know, gives those guys a little bit better chance, and a little bit better chance to break through.
That's right, yeah. So we've been talking over all the shots this end, and we've got Jeff Stoughton throwing his first here in the first end. He's got a bunch of rocks in the house, but Carruthers currently laying shots. Stoughton is trying a quiet bump back. Wants to get at least to the nose, if not inside. Remove this rock cleanly.
Yep. Yes! Yes! Hard!
Makes the hit. Rolls it in behind. Gets it cleanly out of the house. Lovely shot from Jeff Stoughton. Rolls it pretty much right to the button. Currently sits 5 for sure. I don't know if that one on the left is in. Way over on the left. It might be.
The good news for Reid is this is the first shot of the end for him.
Yeah.
He's like, let's listen in here, see what they think.
Yeah. Firm. Yeah. Call it?
Sure.
Okay.
In this situation, if this was Reed's last stone, you'd likely see him drawing to give up one.
Yes, absolutely. You would not be playing a run back against this many enemy rocks.
Oh, stay with
based on the overhead, I don't think that one way on the left is touching the rings, so I'm going to estimate Stoughton laying 5. This is kind of a big shot early for Reid, playing a run back, wants to at very least move this one off the button and open up the scoring area. He's probably going to be forced to one this end. He wants to make sure he has a big area to draw to. Like it needs to curl to get anything. Oh, misses everything in the house.
Yeah, I think it's a little further out. Is that okay?
At the end of the day, even though they left that guard up there, it's probably not the end of the world. Reid should have both draws here to give up a point in the first end. So Stoughton's just going to throw up the guard up front. And then you'll see Reid likely throw the outturn draw. Put the right-hand side of the sheet there.
Put it in the 4-foot.
Yeah.
Give up one, yeah.
Even fully in the 8-foot.
Fully in the 8-foot
like
will actually
be
do
even
it.
Enough.
Yep.
Sometimes you just got to minimize the damage out there.
Yep, that's definitely what's happened in the first end. This end's kind of gotten away from Reid a little bit.
Yeah, right in the middle of that hole would be nice.
Jeff Stoughton's final rock on the way, just playing a
center
guard.
Easy right now. Whoa, just clean. Just clean, it's good.
Goodbye, Jeff.
Gets it tight to the house and nicely executed.
It's, you know what, that's a situation where I think it would have been good for Jeff to bite the 12 foot there.
It would have been.
Just put another one in the ring.
One interesting, yeah. It would have made it interesting for sure.
Because there's no, he's never playing any kind of hit on that redstone anyways.
No, absolutely
so
not.
So he could have been into the 12 foot. He could have been fully, you know, bite the eight foot even too.
Yeah.
That's just as fresh as this outturn drop.
Yeah, Reed's looking at what he's got, and he does have the outturn draw there. Got it on both sides, but it's going
to
be a slightly fresh path, possibly, so it's a little bit of a guess.
Now, there is the chance to score here. That redstone is fully in the 4-foot, not touching the button. The button is still available here, so if he can get enough swing, essentially get side of the button, he can score here.
Yes,
so,
he can. Absolutely.
Here's only one.
Yeah, and he does have backing too, as Braden pointed out.
Yeah,
today, boys? I don't think there'll be that much right here. Okay, let's go.
So, last rock coming down for Reid Carruthers. Big shot throwing against,
inside, Derek,
looks like,
inside.
Five. Grabs full 8 foot. It'll cut it to one.
Line's real good. Gotta go.
Sweepers Hodgson, Samogalski trying to bring this into the button area.
To the tee.
Derek, inside.
Whoa, take a look. Take a look. Tee.
Go.
And just not going to get enough curl here. 1 point for Red. Yep. Jeff Stoughton.
One point steal for Jeff Stoughton, but still a nice pressure shot for Reid Carruthers to limit the damage. So Carruthers will have the hammer again in the second. He'll try again to get his deuce. We can take a brief look around the other sheets. Sheet B is Adam Casey versus Paul Pustovar. And it looks to me, if I saw the scoreboard correctly, that Paul Pustovar opened with 4 in the first end against Adam Casey. So big start there.
Yeah, that's an important game for the Casey team. They're 2-1 right now and have John Epping in their last game. So, they want to make sure they get that third win somewhere. They do have the best shootout in the event so far. So, 3-2 probably gets Casey into the playoffs, but you can't go losing to a team like Pustovar, who, while good, you got to take take those games.
Yes, yeah, that's a game that you would definitely favor Adam Casey to win. But, it's only the first end. So on sheet C, looks like Team China versus John Epping, and Team China took one. On sheet E, it's Trevor Bonneau versus Craig Brown. Bonneau taking 2. Over on sheet F, Brady Clark versus Scott Dunham, and Scott Dunham opens with a score of 1.
Yeah, that Bono team, not a lot of fans out there will know much about these guys, but they've put a lot of effort in this season. They've traveled quite a bit. I know they came to Southern Ontario and played a few events, and they've been down here in the in this area quite a bit. I believe they went to Portage for the Canada Inns event as well, and they're going to be one of the favorites in Northern Ontario to challenge Brad Jacobs for the provincial spot there.
And also to challenge Jeff Curry, who is the current Northern Ontario champion.
Yeah, I'd probably put Curry and Bono in a similar ranking. Mm-hmm. Jacobs is the obvious.
Jacobs is the obvious favorite for sure.
Yeah, so, between those guys. And, of course, you always wonder whether Al Hackner's playing down, because that guy just is timeless.
He just doesn't matter how old he is. He just wins games, makes shots. Yeah, we saw the Bono rank a couple weeks ago in Eveleth at the Kurumasabi Classic. He played very well there. So first,
Connor Negevin throwing the lead stones here. His sister actually won the Manitoba Junior Provincials last weekend. And Connor was on the mic for a couple of the games. They were streaming the men's and women's junior finals last
Very
weekend.
Good.
So Connor works for Curl Manitoba as well, does a lot of media and communication stuff with them. And another guy who's integrated pretty well into the sport. And I think him and Alex have played pretty well this season. I've seen some of their games where they've just shot the lights out. Streamed a couple of Stoughton games earlier this season, and they've really impressed me, to be honest. And now the question is, consistency and getting those kinds of games out of this young front end all the time.
Right. This one gets just snuck by. Not sure hits it hard enough to get it out of the rings. Will not hang on. Will hang on. Stoughton Rock might still just barely be shot. Jeff doesn't like that rock there. So he's asking for a second Alex Forrest to make the nose hit.
Yeah, a little bit more history on this front end. They played last season with Willie Leiber.
Very good.
Alex Forrest, Canadian junior runner-up, I believe in 2010.
Hard!
Hard, guys.
Rex the guard.
So it looks like Reed's asking here for the draw to the rock in the back of the rings.
Yeah, with that wreck, it's opened it pretty wide up, and
that's the kind of mistake in that spot. That those are the things that this young front end needs to learn.
Yes,
you know, without the hammer here, Stoughton, you know, if that center guard would have still been there, you know, it's an okay end. Instead, what he did is he's actually created two corner guards now for Carruthers to use, and this is going to put Stoughton on the chase all end long.
If this needs to be get to it, and it's actually going to slide past everything.
Even an outright miss here by Carruthers' team, and Stoughton is still in trouble.
Yes. Yeah, he's still not going to be in the control spot. One good draw around. Carruthers will have his deuce set up.
Hit this right on the nose, keep a center guard out front.
She rolls just a little bit. May barely be on the house.
Or double it. Good. Oh, it's easy.
Played with the right weight. The little hit and roll here. Get the double and roll behind the corner guard.
Yeah, I think the double's kind of a bonus. He definitely wants to roll behind the corner.
I think he's looking for the nice weight. I think this is what you would these guys would classify this as.
Yeah, that seems to be a Manitoba thing. I hear Stoughton call it too. Yeah. Nice, I think, is kind of a what we would call control here in the States.
Yeah.
Roll. Makes the roll.
They're on the roll.
Sticks on the back one, but rolls pretty well covered.
That's a great shot. Three quarters buried underneath the corner guard. Again, the jam not critical here. He'd love to have made that double and not jammed, but you know, now again he pushes Stoughton. He's chasing around these corner guards.
Right. Yeah, the roll was the key there.
So we were talking about provincial playdowns earlier as well. Jeff Stoughton, for the first time since, I believe, 2007, they actually had to enter the regional playdowns. They've earned their berth into the Manitoba Men's Provincials through CTRS or returning champion, all these other different options in the past. And, of course, they went, I believe, 3-0, 4-0, qualifying A-side in their region. Not much of a surprise there. They beat Braden Calvert in the final. And of course, Calvert went on to win the Manitoba Junior Men's Provincials.
Right.
Calvert booked his spot into the Men's Provincials on the B-side.
Okay. So, very good.
The two finalists in Manitoba in the Junior Provincials, Calvert and
Dunstone.
Matt Dunstone, are both in the Manitoba Men's Provincials as well.
Wow. Good deal.
Lots of good young players coming up the pipe in Manitoba there. And I believe both Dunstone and Calvert have multiple years of juniors left, too.
Do they really?
Yeah.
Hasn't one of them won a Canadian juniors recently?
Both did. They're the last two Canadian junior champions.
Oh, my goodness.
Dunstone 2 years ago. Calvert won it last year.
Oh.
And of course, they had to play each other in the final in the province to even get to the Canadians. Great freeze there by Braden Muscawi. Muscawi, another player with a great junior pedigree. Champion in 2011. Yeah.
And then 2 years later, followed that up with a Saskatchewan Provincial Men's Championship, playing for, I believe it was Rock Virtue? Was it? No,
yes.
Not. Okay.
Two-time Saskatchewan champion, I believe. Maybe they only won it once.
I think it was just one time.
Yeah. An interesting story about Muscawi. That year they won the Canadian juniors, they actually got an invite to a Grand Slam event in Dawson Creek, Alberta. You know, being juniors, you know, no money. The four of them drove from, two from Regina, picked up the other two in Saskatoon, and drove cross-country to Grand Prairie, Alberta, something like 15 hours to get to Dawson Creek.
Wow, that's a long trip. So we've got a question about how much difference does the handle make when looking for a roll? And I suppose that means which turn.
You get a different direction of the roll depending on which turn you throw. I always forget which one will roll flatter versus a little steeper angle. If you're like for example, you make the hit here with the counterclockwise turn from the overhead that we were looking at there, it would check and the handle would change.
Mm-hmm.
So now the handle would rotate in a, if it's rotating on the curl side, it will actually pull it and make it roll on a steeper angle.
Right.
If the rotation is up towards the thrower,
mm-hmm.
it'll actually roll on a flatter rotation.
Right. Yeah, I think it has something to do with how it's going to bounce off. If you're only hitting a rock on one side, it's going to rotate depending on where it hits.
Yeah.
And I think the big question is, does it change direction?
It can change handles depending on the way it hits.
Right.
Just the natural friction of when these two stones contact. The other thing that sometimes you'll see is that when players, for example, are throwing peels, they'll put a little bit more rotation on the handle.
Right.
And the more rotation you have on the rock when it hits, the more action you'll actually get on your shooter as well.
Right.
So it'll kick a little harder. Yeah. You know, if you normally throw 2.5-3 rotations on your draws and hits and stuff like that, but you want to help your peels out a little bit, if you could put 3-4 rotations on a peel,
mm-hmm.
you'll get a little bit more action and help get that shooter out of play. You'll hit near nose and still be able to
still roll it out.
Get that action to get it out of the way.
Yeah, I've seen some players that if they're throwing, say, a hit and roll out to blank the end, they will throw a little extra handle to make sure that the rock spins out.
Exactly the
Definitely.
Same thing. It's something that, again, it takes a little bit of a skill, a little bit of practice to do that, because if you, a lot of times, you know, if you try and put more rotation on the rock, you know, you'll
spin it offline and wind up missing it. You don't want to do that.
Yeah, certainly. It's a pretty good skill to have to be able to throw that half rotation knuckleball on ice where you're not getting much curl, up to 7-8 rotations on a stone if you can, to get a little bit more action and get a little bit more of a consistent lesser curl on stones.
Right.
7-8.
Reid Carruthers' first rock of the second end, coming down here, trying to freeze.
No, Colin. Yep. Whoa.
Whoa,
wait,
Colin,
only.
Whoa.
Derek.
Whoa.
Nice shot, Reid.
Weld it right on there. Very nicely done. So if Jeff wants to get rid of that, he's going to have to hit it on the outside.
Might get lose it. That one now.
He might take that one, yeah.
Get it all the way across. Might actually lose everything if he hits this just right.
Take them all out here.
Again, precision weight. Great sweeping to bring those stones right down. The ice here in Blaine at the Four Seasons Curling Club has been great all weekend.
Yep.
Testament to new facility and Todd Bird, the ice maker, and his staff here. I think the curlers have been pleasantly impressed.
That was a direct quote from, I believe, Steve Laycock after the first game. John Benton went up to him and asked how the ice was, and Steve said he was pleasantly surprised.
Yeah.
So that is a testament to Todd Burr and the crew here at Four Seasons. They've done a great job. I think all the players are very impressed with this facility and this event. It bodes well for the future.
Yeah, the field here, you look at Adam Casey, you've got John Epping's team, Laycock, as you were mentioning, Carruthers, Stoughton. I'm not sure any of these guys have actually been down in the United States to curl in if they have, it's been quite some time. So,
yeah.
I know there was a great event in North Dakota, probably going back 10 years ago now. So Stoughton might have played in that one.
Mm-hmm.
I believe Donnie Barkham was involved in
running
that event, and they gave away a pretty nice purse. But since then, you know, I think Utica did a solid event on the East Coast.
Utica did. There was one at the Broomstones Club in Massachusetts that I know John Morris came down to a couple times years ago.
It's going back quite a ways, too. But even that event, while it was a good event, doesn't even come close to the field we've managed here. So last stone here, second end, Carruthers drawing for his single point.
Yeah. 2015 U.S. Open of Curling is brought to you by Twin Cities Gateway, the official lodging partner providing reduced-rate hotel stays at North Metro Hotels for all Four Seasons guests and their families. You can find them at tcgateway.com. Also sponsored by Super 8 of Blaine, the official host hotel of the U.S. Open of Curling. So it's pretty nip-and-tuck game so far. Some good shot-making, good freezes, good hits. Take a brief look around the ice at the scores. Taking a look at the game between Adam Casey and Pustovar on sheet B, and Paul Pustovar so far laying the wood to Adam Casey, stealing two more.
Goes from bad to worse over there for Team Casey.
Yeah, I'm sure Casey didn't imagine being down 6-0 after two ends, but that's where he finds himself, so he's really going to have to pull all the rabbits out of his hat to try and come back in that one. In the sheet C, John Epping secures a deuce against Team China. They are playing the third end, China with Hammer.
Got those great History TV channel, History TV uniforms on Team Epping.
Yeah, I've had people ask, how in the world do you get sponsored by History Channel? I can only assume one of them must work for the History Channel.
No, but it sounds like they have a contact there of some sort to make that work.
Outstanding.
Yeah, it's you know, it's a pretty interesting connection because you know, these guys curl in the Grand Slams regularly, and it's a perfect sponsorship when you think about it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, these guys will get on TV a fair bit, and you know, most people are watching the games on TV. It's a pretty easy option that, hey, let's watch some History TV afterwards. You know,
absolutely. Yep.
They do have a great show on that channel called Mountain Men. Yep. I actually caught myself watching some of that on the
watched a little bit of that.
Hard guys, gotta
on,
go.
The weekend they had a marathon on
really
that.
Really hard.
They've really been promoting that show as well with their sponsorship.
Whoa.
So
right.
Some really good tie-ins there. I know they've done they've done a couple promos, I believe, with the History Channel too, and
okay.
That was part of the plan. And
sure.
It's a great tie-in for the game, and you know, the uniforms look great too. We've got some great sponsors here for Carruthers. They've got Princess Auto as their title sponsor, signed on this year. Again, another value add kind of part of the proposal. You know, they'll show up at stores.
Mm-hmm.
So they went to Toronto to an event, and they showed up at the Princess Auto store there and did a little appearance. And,
okay.
And Reed's background, he's a shop teacher.
Oh, okay.
And,
very good.
One of the things that Princess Auto wants to do is help their staff learn more about products so that they can then, in turn, sell product and
right.
be a bit more knowledgeable. And I believe the tie-in there is Reid is going to work with the staff and the Princess Auto to kind of do this sort of education portion
okay.
as well. Kind of this unique tie-in to sponsorship.
Right.
You know, the sponsor gives this back, and the team in turn gives something back
sure.
to the sponsor.
Right. Those are good opportunities that teams seem to be able to secure in Canada. I mean, you still have to know people, but a similar type of arrangement down here in the United States is much, much tougher to get simply because, you know, curling just doesn't have the exposure down here that it does in Canada, and it's not quite in the culture in the same way.
Yeah, I agree with that. I think
ready.
You're starting
yep.
to see some differences
yep.
in that, but it's about getting creative.
Yes!
Right.
I've seen some teams out here that, you know, that they've got more sponsorship than maybe they deserve based on how good of a team
side.
They are.
Yeah.
But they put in the work to go get it done.
Exactly.
And you know what? A sponsorship dollar is just as good as a dollar one on the ice.
That's right. Absolutely. So we had a pretty standard start to this end.
I don't like that much.
Carruthers threw the guard.
What?
Stoughton tried to come around but wrecked to a corner, so not bad.
You're right.
Just gonna stay with it.
A freeze was made. Carruthers is calling for the freeze again, but it looks like it's all there.
No, needs to walk all on its own, all on its own.
Comes up and
oh man,
just gets there, but doesn't really get the angle that Reid wanted. Stoughton is asking second Alex Forrest to play the freeze pretty much right on the face of the just placed Carruthers rock.
How heavy?
Top eight, top four.
Yep. Whoa, whoa. Whoa, 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 if you can. You gotta curl just a little bit.
Sails in.
Good.
A pretty good spot. Reid taking a long look at the house. He doesn't really like how this is setting up right now.
I think we got to move him. We can't leave this like this. We got to bump it and do something.
Yeah, I have a feeling that years curled number there.
Yeah, I somehow don't think Derek has curled for 2,000 years.
Yeah, we've got Joe getting a little creative. That's 2015 minus 2007. Gives us, what, about 8 years? Yeah.
I think if we go here, he just
Derek Semigalski, a relative newcomer to the curling game, actually, when you think about his age and you know how long he's curled and gotten to the elite level here.
Yeah, very fast descent. Got to the Brier in 2012 as Manitoba champ, playing with Rob Fowler.
I don't know what we can really do. We gotta just move these and try and set something up.
This Carruthers team here is actually a bit of a mixed bag of different provinces. All four players coming from separate teams last year. Like you're saying, Samogalski with Fowler. Muscawi curled out of Saskatchewan last year. Lived in Regina, I believe, curling with Brock Virtue. Colin Hodgson played out of Alberta last year with Charlie Thomas.
All right, Charlie Thomas.
Charlie Thomas might be known to many American fans. World Junior Champion the year it was in Evelyn.
Oh, yes. Okay. That was 2008?
6, 7, 8,
somewhere in that range.
So Colin's kind of been all over the place. He is a character, shall we say.
That's what I hear. He's a colorful guy.
If you're not following Colin on Instagram, you really should be. He's an accomplished chef, and he tweets a lot about food and stuff like that as well. And he does some work with the Winnipeg Blue Bombers football team. And he's picked up some pretty interesting gigs when it comes to cooking and catering and private stuff as well. And he's always fun to follow along with.
Alex Forrest gets a little bit of a jiggle on rocks with his second shot. Doesn't hold anything. Moves Carruthers rock out in the open. Way out to the right. Making Reid and Braden look at this and decide what to do.
It's the best shot if you can make it.
Yeah.
Speed, you thought was good here, Reid?
Yeah, it's good speed.
Corner freeze it. Actually, such a bad shot, it was good. Top eight, guys. Yeah, I'm throwing like it's normal.
It's an interesting comment, so bad it's good. Because it wasn't really what Stoughton wanted, but it actually made it, so really neither one of those Stoughton rocks can be removed easily.
Derek, you're in. Looks there, looks there. Looks heavy. Derek's in, go ahead. Line's good.
Just top eight.
All the way, guys.
Yep.
Good.
Settles in to just biting the top of the 12 foot. It cuts off any kind of play Stoughton might have made over there.
You want to get it now, or do you want to just do that?
Talking to Rob about maybe playing the slash double, or just the hit and roll under the corner.
Why do you want to hit that?
So you play this, you go roll right behind the corner. Is that what you're thinking?
Yeah, either we're playing to get rid of this now, or we play to stick this here.
Well, you can throw a bumper, get rid of it, roll behind the corner. It's pretty good, eh?
Well, I want to get rid of this one.
What's that?
I'd rather get rid of this one than this one. Because this one's helping us. This one's doing nothing for us. So do this or rip it.
Half rock.
To rip it, quarter.
Quarter?
Quarter to hit it.
Yeah.
So it's just a big difference. Either if we don't hit this one's good.
Yeah.
That one can go. They'll play the run back double.
Okay.
So it's whether we want to...
Ball with bumper then?
Yeah, I just roll here is no good. Let's just peel it out.
So we had an extensive discussion about whether to play quiet, hit half a rock, roll into the corner, or just hit a quarter to a third and make the double and just lose the shooter. It's like Jeff has decided to have Rob
double the yellows.
Throw a big weight and make the double. Jeff said it's about a quarter rock to make this double.
Whoa.
Got very thin. It's one.
Good shot.
Nice double by Rob Fowler. And that will leave Jeff Stoughton lying two.
Fowler with the Larry long slide delivery there, tracking the stone all the way down the sheet.
Something you see Stoughton do from time to time, too.
You got it. These guys got such perfect slides coming out that they just, their natural momentum is
just keeps
takes
on
them
going
right down the sheet.
Go, yep.
So that's going to leave a run back double for Braden Moskowy. It and gets both of them out of there too, so two back-to-back great shots. With that, Reid Carruthers lies three all across the front of the house.
This bumper.
It does open up the scoring area a little bit for Jeff. He can play a hit and roll and get set behind two rocks. Casey has not been able to stop the bleeding over on sheet B. He gives up another steal.
Yep.
And Pustovar now leads 7-0 after three ends.
Yep. Whoa, 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 yes, hard, whoa.
Whoa.
Get under there, holy shit.
Rob Fowler just can't quite get buried. Rolls a little bit, but I think Reid can just see all of it. Sheet F, Brady Clark takes one to tie it against Scott Dunham. On sheet E, Craig Brown takes one.
Okay.
Which hands the hammer back to Trevor Bonneau, who's now leading 2-1.
Very conservative, yeah. That one right there. I like that.
So if anybody out there wants to throw any questions out to us here on the forums, be sure to post it in the chat window. There's also a Twitter account that they can fire questions out to as well.
Yeah, that's at, see it on the screen there, it's at 12th End Sports.
Nicely done.
They have,
they're on the ball over there at the controls.
We have Joe monitoring that Twitter feed, but obviously if you're watching the video, you can easily just post a question in the chat window and we're monitoring that.
A little shameless self-promotion. You can also fire something to @CurlingZone if you really want to as well.
Absolutely.
We just fired out a little tweet, make sure everybody knows about this broadcast as well.
So Reid Carruthers' first rock. Yep. Wants to make this hit.
Yep. Yep. Hard! Hard!
Just gets by. Doesn't really roll anywhere. Good shot.
You think that's enough to get in there?
Right. Turn across the face.
Yeah. 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 I just want to make sure we get shot. So yeah, I think we should with nice, half a rock and get it in there.
Yeah, we can roll into it. But I don't think you can roll under it with nice weight.
Yeah. Okay. Nice weight. Yeah. I'm just got to make sure we get the roll. Yep. Okay. Maybe there. Yep. Should curl. Yeah, a little bit.
Some might ask what exactly
is nice weight.
Is nice weight.
Control weight, I think.
Yeah, we were talking about it a little earlier.
Nice, yeah.
I said it's kind of the Manitoba equivalent of control weight. We usually call it control down here.
Yeah, you see it a little bit different. They use different terminology in different places. In Scotland, you got the good old barrier
weight.
Nothing like hearing Anna Sloan and her Scottish
accent. You about it?
We don't need we don't need impersonations here.
Too bad, you already got one.
A nice hit and roll there by Stoughton. A little nice weight, gets the curl across the face. Now sits shot underneath cover.
See how Reid wants to play this. He might play off of his own. They're mostly level. The yellow is ever so slightly deeper than the red, but peel weight, two-thirds of a rock. This should shoot pretty cleanly all the way across the house. Final stone for Reid Carruthers. Going to be throwing some heat at this one.
Wants to hit this one pretty thick enough that he comes across flat. Yeah. He's got a long way to get that redstone out of the rings.
Got to push it all the way across the house.
Looks like this might hit it at too thin.
It's gotta
gets the action. Can't sweep it. Can't sweep it,
but gets it all the way out.
Look at this. Great stones here, too. Lots of good reaction off of them. I didn't even think that with where they hit that would have enough spring to get out the side of the sheet.
Yeah, these are some decently lively rocks. And Reid's happy that they're decently lively.
Another steal for Pustovar over on sheet B. Now 7-0.
Yeah, not sure what's going on, but Adam Casey is in tough. Pustovar now lying 3.
It's another team here, I think, that you look at inconsistency as probably their biggest enemy. And, you know, it's a young team like that, especially his front end.
Yeah.
And the other three, Casey's got tons of experience. But, you know, maybe looking ahead to that final game against John Epping and not taking a team like Pustovar seriously enough.
Yeah, you can't really look past anybody in this field. So this is Jeff Stoughton's final rock, just drawing into the forefoot to take one.
Come on, guys.
Stoughton said he thought it was light out of his hand, so he's urging them on.
Light the 4. Whoa, if you can.
Hard, guys.
Yep.
It will settle nicely into the top of the button to score one. That will put Jeff Stoughton up by a score of 2-1. Fourth end coming. Reid Carruthers will have the hammer back. Here's a crowd shot of what's behind us here at the Four Seasons Curling Club. And this is Gabe's Ringside Bar and Grill right behind us. It's a really happening place. Beautiful facility, only built a couple years ago.
Yeah, it's really well set up here next door to the hockey arena. You get a pretty good crowd coming in and out as well.
Absolutely. Nice facility. Definitely one of the premier in the United States. This place, this club was, facility was recently named the National Training Center for USA Curling.
First stone, fourth end here. Connor Negevin looking for a center guard.
Somebody on the stream is asking if it's true that Connor Negevin can bench over 100 pounds more than his body weight. I wish I had the answer to that.
That I did not actually know.
We may have to check on that one and get back to you.
That's one thing. It is a good question, though. You talk about fitness, and it's something that has really changed the dynamic of the game. You go back and you look at the teams out of Canada, for example. The fittest team in 2010 was Kevin Martin's team.
Oh, yeah.
I don't think there was any question about that.
By leaps and bounds.
You know, you really had... three players in front of Kevin who looked the part, but even Kevin himself was very fit and very great, good shape.
Oh yes.
No.
And it really took them through the long haul of what it takes to win the trials.
Mm-hmm.
And then again in 2014 in the trials ahead of those Olympics, you look at the fittest team there was Brad Jacobs.
Okay.
And I think I think most teams had sort of had closed the gap. But what Jacob's team did is they really took fitness to a whole new level. Supplements and physical training, weight training, and strength training as well that brought them to the next level. So you look at it, front end from Stoughton's team, they're both young, and I would imagine, I don't know for sure, but they probably hit the gym well and put in a lot of commitment time there. And same thing with Carruthers and his team as well.
Want to.
We've got a question in the chat that is asking, how do they determine the final two playoff spots? I'm presuming that's talking about the playoff spots here.
It's not really a final two playoff spots. What they do is they take the best eight records, period.
Yep.
Doesn't matter which pool they come from, doesn't matter any of that setup. So basically, what you really should do is you just look at the entire... list ranking of all the teams, and the best eight teams are going to be in the playoffs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's basically set up here to where if you only have one loss, you are not eliminated. There would be a tiebreaker of some sort.
Yeah, there's a hypothetical scenario where
very unlikely.
Yeah, nine teams could go 4-1.
Right, but I think that might already be off the board.
Yes, yeah, it doesn't look like that's going to happen. It's the same format as the Grand Slams.
Yep.
And the only issue here is we don't really have time for tiebreakers.
Mm-hmm.
They did put a tiebreaker option in there for that 4-1, so it wasn't a single knockout event for somebody.
Right. Yep.
But top eight records from across all pools will qualify. So. Hypothetically, you could have eight teams from two pools and one pool with nobody qualifying.
That's right.
Very unlikely, possible.
If the pool beats the hell out of each other and no one has a good draw shot, it could certainly happen.
Yeah.
You know, and sure. And teams with two losses can be eliminated if their draw shot challenge is not particularly good.
Got a good comment here from Lon Pepper, Cedar Rapids Curling Club. He said he heard Jacob's team can bench press Buicks.
I wouldn't put it past them. Now, if they're talking, you know, old Buicks from the 70s and 60s, the land barges, that would be pretty impressive. I'd like to see that.
Buick, of course, not a sponsor, but you know what? If Buick of America would get themselves sponsored here, maybe we can set up a little demo and see if
we could
get Jacobs down here and see if they can bench press some Buicks.
The Jacobs challenge.
Yeah.
Jacobs Buick challenge.
See, you got to get a little creative in these sponsorship campaigns, right?
Yeah. That's what you were saying.
Of course, wouldn't want to leave Team Stoughton out. They've got Walgreen as their title sponsor. Fowler Hyundai, I know, is on one of the arm sleeves there. Air Canada, supporters of the team as well.
Apparently, Rob Fowler is a general manager of Fowler Hyundai. I'm assuming that's a family business.
It's the family business. Brian and Lois Fowler, and then his parents, and pass it down to Rob, who was involved there as well.
Brian Fowler, a one-time Manitoba champ back in the 80s, I think, wasn't it?
Yeah, I believe he did win one as a skip, and of course Lois Fowler's won some Manitoba Scotties as well, so there's a lot of curling pedigree in that Fowler family.
Very good.
Millimeter high!
Just back ring. Yeah. I'm trying to hit like three quarters with back eight or so and line it up on that.
So
just trying to scrape the guard with back eight.
Sheet B. Adam Casey has a draw. Basically, with a full 4 foot to pick up one. Postbar laying two. He would certainly like to finally get on the board. We'll see if he makes this. If they keep going down six without hammer with four ends left to go, is pretty tough spot no matter who you're playing.
No, Colin, no.
Not bad.
Pretty good.
Not bad.
Angle set up pretty nicely there for Carruthers. Looks like Carruthers lying one right now.
Adam Casey's draw is coming down, and the sweepers have no interest in it whatsoever. And this is going to slide deep again.
And
another steal of one, and that's going to go down as an 8-0 Pustovar win. Not the kind of game Adam Casey wanted to play tonight, but they'll regroup.
Shocker.
Yeah, that's a.
What's been in the water here today in Blaine? Because it's been upset city all day long.
I don't know.
Opening draw, you saw Laycock, you saw at least one other pretty major upset as well. It's certainly not the ice conditions, because there's no excuses with how good this ice is out here and the rocks as well.
No, some
hard line.
Sometimes you just have an off game, but it's odd to see
hard
a collection
line,
like we've seen.
Come on,
saw last night,
low,
Pustovar had a pretty significant lead on the Chinese team, but gave it back in the space of three ends and wound up losing that game.
Well, team discussion. Make more peels, guys. Came out, solved that problem today.
Okay.
Fowler high with the draw.
Right in the nose.
Okay. Looks a hair high to me.
Had somebody ask, who is Pustovar?
Dead Beach.
Somebody in Canada probably wouldn't know him. He's
one
of the better known curlers down here in the States. He's been playing for a very long time.
Multiple time U.S. national champion. Definitely a senior by now.
Oh, yes.
Is he into Masters by at this point?
I believe he could be.
Yeah.
Yep.
But even now, he's still making qualified for the U.S. Nationals last year. Not a good result on that last shot there by Braden Moskowy.
Yeah, they tickled all of their rocks and didn't really move anything of Stoughton's. Not a good result.
Carruthers still sitting shot, back of the forefoot.
Maybe this might be better.
But anyways, Pustivar, good, you know, he's had a good run in the game. And as I was just going to finish, he qualified for the U.S. Nationals last year and playing down again this season.
Yeah, he always, I think he plays just because he still really enjoys playing at a high level. Not really so sure he's concerned about putting in the work to you know, win it all necessarily, but he has the time, he has the ability to do it, and so that's why he plays.
It's a good old classic men with brooms scenario that, you know, watch out for those guys with walkers coming out because you know they're going to have draw weight.
Yep.
Can't get too cocky when you're playing against those guys.
For sure. Big turn on sheet E. Trevor Bonneau against Craig Brown. Bonneau had a big weight double to score two, but wrecked on a guard. So that's going to give Craig a steal of two, and he's going to claim the lead at 3-2.
Yep, whoa. Yep. Shit.
Stop. Makes the roll in, but suddenly that Carruthers Rock back four is getting pretty tough to move. There's a phalanx of red rocks in front of it that makes it really, really difficult to move.
The other option here is, I think Reid's looking at it. I wonder if he can hit it hard on the nose and get all three of those red stones moving.
Firm. Okay. It's millimeter high.
Millimeter, yeah. Nose gets away with it.
Yeah, nose is good.
Where's that center one
nose
going?
Is good.
I think even if that center stone spills in for shot, Carruthers has a couple options.
Yeah.
Yeah, shoot me a hair more.
Wants to keep his shooter there in the front so that it doesn't, he blocks that control zone. Sitting first and third or second and third is a great setup.
Yep, yep, whoa.
Yep.
Whoa.
Squeezes it in a little bit, but Carruthers remains shot back 4 foot.
Stick it there.
Yep. Yeah, I think he wanted to hit a hair on the inside, kick his shooter underneath. So
I think bumper should be good.
Good result, but does leave Stoughton the opportunity to hit the front one.
Yeah, a little more.
Good comment from our in our chat window there. Pustivar is a World Seniors champion.
That's right. I believe I want to say that was 3 years ago, give or take.
Close. Whoa. Wants to get to the nose or slightly inside here. Doesn't want to touch his own.
He moves his own.
And that's not a good result. Stoughton is sitting 2, 3, and 4. Carruthers with a lonely shot stone here. So at the end of the day, it works out okay. Could have been a lot better, though.
Yeah, not bad, but not great.
Right now, Stoughton does have a short run back to score 3 or 4. Sorry, to sit 3 or 4. Carruthers, of course, with the hammer here in the fourth end.
Do you think it would be any good for him to try some kind of a double on those two top reds, maybe even by running it back?
Derek Samogalski indicating the run back, yellow under the two red.
As long as you're high. Like if
yeah,
you're,
I'm kind of looking at that.
To be honest, a shot like that helps guarantee scoring one a little bit, too.
Yes, it does.
You know, removing those two red Stoughton stones. Those are stones that are in a dangerous spot right now for Carruthers.
Yeah.
Where can he tap? He's got to tap it.
He's got to tap it frozen.
It's not bad.
There's lots of misses. Everywhere there's misses.
Yeah.
Got to make a shot.
Yeah. It's just a matter. I'm not in love with that. I just think he's going to make that slash double on us, probably. You guys don't like this?
I was asking, do rocks ever break?
Yeah, you can. For sure.
Supposedly, I've never seen it happen.
I've never seen it happen either.
Or we played that. I didn't mind this. This is kind of my first
it's
shot.
Something, what they do is if a rock breaks, they count the biggest piece.
And then we might have off of it.
Wherever it comes to rest. Get somebody like Jason Gunnlaugsson throwing a 3.5-second bomb, you could easily see a rock break at some point.
Yeah, it's something I've heard. It's a question of whether the quality of granite. Right now, hurling stones come from one place, the granite used. But I've heard some Chinese manufacturers working on rocks in China.
Really?
Using their own stones. And the granite isn't quite dense enough, and I've heard of some stones breaking there.
Yeah, breaking or at the very least chipping.
Yeah. It really comes down to having the right density and strength of the stone. You think you could put any kind of stone out there and bang them around, but you can, these stones take quite a beating over time.
I seem to remember hearing a couple years ago about somebody somewhere, it may have been Canada Curling Stone, was worried about the supply of granite dwindling to the point where they couldn't make stone, so they were looking into artificial ways of making rocks, like making ceramic rocks.
Yeah, I believe some of that has to do with the island, and I believe it's a protected...
it's like a wildlife reserve or something like that.
Like, it's an uninhabited island for people, but there's a lot of other stuff going on, so there's always concerns about blasting and all that stuff they need to do to mine the granite off of Elsa Craig. Brothers looking for the hit and roll here undercover. This shot here, I was talking about the run back being kind of the shot to guarantee you score, maybe get and more likely to get your two. This shot here, a little bit more risk reward. Playing this hit and roll underneath, Stoughton still does have that run back with his own or tap into the pocket there.
Yeah.
But if Stoughton misses this, Carruthers will have the chance to maybe score three or four.
Yeah.
Higher risk shot here by Carruthers. And to be honest, four wins right now on the board already.
Why
I'm
not
surprised to see him play this.
Yeah.
A loss here is not going to eliminate him.
Yep.
And, but if he can score a three or four here, he might be able to find a way to get off the ice a little earlier.
Right.
Try and get it in here.
He's basically already booked his spot in the playoffs, so like you said, risk reward. The only thing I don't like about it is that it kind of makes Stoughton's tap a little bit easier. He's now got a bigger wall to tap it into.
Yeah, he was always going to have that pocket back there. But again, he has to make this shot.
Well, exactly. He has to make it.
Sets up the three at the risk of being forced to a single or giving up a steal.
Right.
Hey, bumper weight was here, right?
Yeah, which is here.
Yeah.
So I don't want to hit on the nose, that's for sure. Yeah. I want to hit it over that way a little bit. Let's go about like that.
Just with, just here, right?
It'll probably be back 12 anyway.
So we've got kind of a question series from Random House, talking about stones and how long they last. The curling stone will typically last somewhere from 25 to 30 years, give or take, based on how much they're played, stuff like that.
Weight doesn't matter.
And after that happens, you'll see stones, they should be conditioned and have their running bands fixed and or put inserts into them. So,
more ice.
We had a question from Texas Curler who said that this being the so-called U.S. Open of Curling, were teams invited to participate or could any team theoretically sign up? U.S. Open is really just the name of the event. No one was invited. Teams could sign up to play.
Yeah,
as long as you had the money to pony up, you could sign up for it.
Open in its name. Sign up to play.
That's right. The entry fee was a little bit over $1,000. I believe with tax it was about $1,070, give or take.
And $7,000 first prize here for the top team.
Yeah, yep. First prize is $7,000.
Whoa! Yep. Whoa, whoa, whoa.
Stoughton with the tap, lying shot, side of the forefoot, fully undercover.
As we were saying, first prize $7,000. If you're the finalist, you lose the final game, that's $4,000. Semi-finalist is $2,500, and just qualifying, that's your team $1,750.
Let's listen in here.
Oh, it's like a centimeter. It's like just grazing it.
That's a very good question. If there is a...
Yeah, that's two options, I guess. You got by tight. Could you ever touch this? All you gotta do is move it an inch.
Maybe.
Probably could, eh?
Yeah.
If you don't touch it, you just come to here.
Yeah, I don't mean that.
I mean...
It's close.
If that was over a foot, I would say 100%. I don't mind trying that. I think it's definitely there.
I think so too. Okay, I'm gonna throw this a little soft and just like this much. Weight.
Yeah, just a
couple
just
shot options
girl.
Here. They were talking about the really, really thin in off for a bunch. Instead, that looks like they're gonna play the just kind of a heavy draw here. If they can get enough curl, get tight around that center guard. They should be able to make contact with that red stone, and they really only need to move it 2-3 inches to score,
to
bring the back stone into play to count.
Move very far at all. They have to get past the guard, and they also have to miss the red in the house pretty tight, too. But if they can do that, they really only need to make contact with this red, and he can get two.
The other option here is you know, the option on this shot is if it runs a little straight, they come to their back yellow one, they'll still count the single point here.
Right. So basically, he just wants to throw pretty much T-line weight. And if the line is good, he can let the sweepers take it and add that little bit of extra momentum.
Reid did mention throwing this soft. So when he says something like that, typically he means not as much rotation on the stone, hoping to let the ice bring it over.
Right, it's only just now getting to 1.5 rotations. It needs to curl to get one. I don't think he's going to get the two.
Single point here, it looks like.
Yep. Gets one, so that'll tie the game up at 2-2. And Stoughton will have the hammer again in the fifth end. A couple more sponsors of the 2015 U.S. Open of Curling include Core Trust Bank, a bank and a commitment to customer service, employees, and profitability. They're at coretrustbank.com. This Open is also sponsored by TSR Injury Law. If you've been injured, then it's TSR time. Their phone number is 612-TSR-TIME. We're going to look at some of the scores. Sheet A. Looks to me as though Corey Dropkin has a 4-2 lead over Mick Lismore. And we're taking a quick look at sheet C, Team China versus John Epping, and this is Team China throwing their final rock of the fifth end. It looks like they have a draw against two. My eyes do not deceive me, and they don't. Just any piece of the forefoot will give them a single point. Sweepers have been on it most of the way, and the third is now coming out to help. They must think it's light. This needs to at least make full eight to cut it down to one. Sweepers are really working this hard. It will make it into the forefoot for 1 point. So some excellent sweeping. And that will close the gap to 4-3, but John Epping will have that lead and the hammer when they start the sixth end.
So, of course, we're just starting the fifth end here. Full end behind that sheet over there. Other games also quite a bit ahead of us here.
Yeah, there have been some fairly busy ends, as you might expect these two teams playing each other.
Yeah, lots of rocks in play. You get a lot of discussion and debate as to what to do out there.
Mm-hmm.
And we're likely going to see more of that here as the center guard goes up. Stoughton goes around.
Yeah, we see a succession of draws and freezes, I would presume.
line.
So there is the reason why going behind the tee line here is a big problem for Stoughton.
Yep, that's a really big problem because that thing is locked right on the front.
Nice job, buddy.
Connor Negevin with his first stone makes a, you know, it's a pretty substantial mistake actually. Doesn't look like a big deal from outside, but goes back four. Carruthers calls on his lead. Colin Hodgson to freeze right to the nose of it. And now it's going to take two shots to get that yellow stone off the button.
Yeah, I know a lead curler will look at that and say, well, it's touching the button. And it's like, well, yeah, it is. But the problem is it's touching the wrong side of the button.
For Stoughton, he would actually prefer that red stone to be back 8, back 12.
Absolutely,
than back
but
four.
Right behind the button like that is not good. But a good comeback shot from Connor Negevin. Gets that one off and leaves his own frozen, so a little bit of a tit for tat. Derek Samogalski is coming down and is being asked to freeze to the pile.
We're five. We're five. Six.
I think we're 2-8.
Yeah, it's good.
Keep going, keep going. Yep.
So some of you might wonder when you hear the skip say switch when they're sweeping. There is a method to the madness behind that. It basically means whoever is closest to the rock, get out of the way and let the other guy get close to the rock.
Job,
and I know the physics behind that, but Jerry, you want to explain the idea behind that?
There's the sweeper who's right on the rock probably does about 70% of the work. And their sweeping does the most, is, you know, does the most effect on the stone. And when you look at the way a rock turns, so for example, if it's turning clockwise, and the sweeper on the right-hand side is sweeping, they will actually can keep it straighter.
Perfect.
So they're sweeping perfect against the curl. So the theory behind that is it actually will keep the stone a little bit straighter, so you'll see in that situation, sometimes they'll sweep
good,
a draw.
We're good, we're good.
You'll see the switch on the draws a lot, where sometimes you want to get a little bit more curl.
Five,
so
six,
it's the sweeping on the other side with the curl, so you're pushing it. You feel like you're pushing it.
Finish it. Go ahead.
You'll get the curl around that side.
Right.
I think our problem here was producer's handwriting, because reference was broom stacking.
Very good. Shut up, man.
But broom stacking is a common terminology here in the United States. That's what you do after the game.
Also, sometimes you'll see these guys swapping brooms depending on the shot. And from what I've seen, usually that happens when you have one sweeper with a synthetic pad and the other one with a hairbrush. And I think usually the idea behind that is you want the hairbrush out in front to clean up the debris.
So it goes similar to the switch.
Yeah, exactly.
So you know which sweeper you want on the stone. So, for example, on a hit where you want it to keep it straight, you put the synthetic brush on the side that the sweeper will tend to keep it straighter.
Yeah.
And then they give the hair broom to the other player to clean out front.
Right. On most hits, that means that you would give the synthetic pad to the close sweeper, because the rock is going to be actually curling towards him, because his sweep will keep their stones straight.
I think we gotta get to nose if we do that.
Yeah, it's something where you've seen you've got these this Carruthers team. They're actually using the new hardline brooms, I believe.
Yeah, the hardline ice pad.
I've heard comments from a couple ice makers that they might be too good.
Yeah, they're definitely a different feel. I personally have used them a couple of times. they are certainly effective.
Yeah. So what you're seeing teams, and I think this Carruthers team is a perfect example of it. Is they're keeping a hair broom out there so that they don't, you know, damage the ice too much.
Right.
You know, if you put two of these hardline brushes out in the ice, and you know you've seen that other thing with some of the other synthetic pads out there, and they just shred the ice. They really take down the pebble, and then by the end of an 8 or 10 end game, it's flat and it's not great conditions to play on. And so you'll see them sweep with one hair broom out front, just to do the clean, to keep the surface clear. Right. And then the sweeper on the stone will have that real good quality synthetic pad.
Right. Yeah. That's a similar kind of discussion came up when the EQ pads first came out. The performance brushes that have the layer of foil underneath to help reflect heat back to the ice.
Yeah.
There was some concern about two already strong brushers using them and literally ripping the pebble right off the ice and the ice being flat.
Yeah, there's a balance between getting the best distance out of a particular shot, but then having playing conditions that allow you to make shots in the last couple ends and not just turn it into a factor of luck out there when, you know, you get picks because of flat spots and you get, you can't throw that draw to the forefoot in the last end. It's really a gong show out there.
Exactly.
Yep. Hard!
They have to go hard to get this by the top one. Just rubs.
They get the rub, and that probably helps the shot a little bit.
Save the shot. Yeah, if it didn't rub, it was probably rolling a long ways off. So a little bit of luck there for Rob Fowler.
Jesus.
And he knows it.
That's incredible. Do you ever just rip it? Rip it? It's tough to get inside that, man. I just sneaked by. Hey? I know, I agree.
Stoughton throwing the red stones with the hammer here in the fifth end.
Laying two.
No real obvious shot here for
Carruthers. Yeah, it's either hit the open one or you could also drive the yellow onto the second shot.
Move back, heavy, control, heavy. Just clean.
Whoa. Whoa.
Clean, whoa. Clean. Yep.
Whoa.
Yep, yep,
yep.
Yep,
yep, yep. Roll it.
The hit is made, and it rolls a little bit away. Settles for second shot on the side of the house. Stoughton still lying one. Fairly well covered.
Nice weight.
At the end of the day, I'm not sure I love that shot there from Carruthers. Other than the fact that they're just delaying making a move on the front ones, and that might be the reasoning for it.
Yeah. I thought maybe he would have played the yellow to red combo, tried to stick that one under the guard and at least get rid of the second
shot. Stick it under the guard.
And open up the shot stone.
Even throw it with something like a hack weight.
Yeah.
Keep your shooter around on the side.
Maybe keep
side of the 8 foot.
Yep. Nose hit is made. I believe. Looks to me like Stoughton is lying two, but he may have set up a double here.
Yeah, this worked out pretty good for Carruthers at the end of the day.
Yeah.
He can just has to hit about a quarter of that yellow stone, come across, make the double on the two reds, and lie three. He'll sit with that stone stuffed underneath, and
Stoughton may be forced to one this end.
Yes.
Nothing but forces so far. No one's been able to secure the deuce.
Guys.
firm weight for Reid Carruthers. Quarter rock double.
Gonna need this to move a bit.
Looks like it needs to come up just a little bit. Gonna get a tiny little piece of the first one. And actually jams it on the side.
Great shot.
A little bit of a double touch there.
Yeah. Don't see that too often. A little bit of rattling and rolling. But when things, the dust settles, he is sitting two. And
one thing though, the redstone on the outside jammed in his lying third shot. So if Stoughton can make this double back, he can lie two now.
The double as it is really steep. He might prefer just to make a hit and roll.
Yeah, they're looking at the hit and roll here. If this is last shot, this double's definitely makeable.
Oh, yes.
He's just trying to make his last shot a little bit easier.
Yeah.
This is what a veteran skip will bring to a team. A little bit of patience here. Mm-hmm. We'll set up an easier deuce at the end of the day. A good roll, you know, half in front of the yellow stone in the back. Carruthers will pretty much be resigned to just peeling it out or opting for the safe side, which means a shooter likely rolls out.
Yeah.
And then Stoughton will be left with an open nose hit.
For two.
For two.
And any deuce in this game is a pretty big one.
Looks real close here.
Looks like it might be over curling just a little bit.
They were on off this all the way down the sheet.
And get the roll.
Yeah, it looks like they did lose a little bit. I think they likely thought Stoughton was going to throw a little bit more weight at this. And based on the sweeping, I think that was the same. You know, they missed the call a little bit on that.
Yeah, he was saying bumper in the hack, and it looked like it might have been just bumper.
Yeah, right.
You go big with it, though, on playing a nice big together.
Right, I agree. Right?
So I like just playing bumper and trying to touch that line.
I agree. Okay. And if you know a bump,
this is actually curl. I think they're
bumper. Yeah.
Nose is okay.
No, I'm going to try. Even if we rolled an inch read.
Hey.
Inches enough.
Bumper. Roll to touch the line. Just roll it an inch is pretty good. Your way, Haji.
Reid is looking to make the hit and roll just about half a rock. He wants to just bite center, I think is what he was talking about.
No!
This is hanging out there. Needs to curl up for Reid.
Whoa!
He's not going to roll the way he wants.
Yep!
Right.
Yep!
And he's going to set up a nose double for Jeff Stoughton to maybe pick up two.
I think PLA, Rob. Nose hit.
A little bit of a sloppy finish to this end here. A couple of half shots on both sides. And Stoughton is left with an opportunity to take a pretty solid lead here. 2-point lead with three ends to go would put him in control here. We talk about the Manitoba tuck. I think there's a bit of discussion going on about that, the type of slide that you see a lot of players out of Manitoba. And that's where... when you watch Jeff slide out here, I think our camera guy can get a good look at this. And as he slides out, he tucks the heel of his slider foot right up into his inside of his
hip.
Yep, yep.
And it's actually, you know, you look at it and you wonder how that is on the knees. And it's actually, if you do it right, it's a very good technical slide. And
Stoughton is a guy who's been throwing that way since the dark ages, and I think his knee is just fine. So
yeah, he's doing well, and again, 2 points here.
Yep.
Great nice. Technical display there by Jeff Stoughton. Makes the double, two stones go away, and he leads 4-2 over Reid Carruthers now after five ends.
It's So just to briefly talk about our next matchup tonight is going to be final round robin game. Is going to be another one versus two match. It's going to be John Epping versus Adam Casey. And Casey is going to definitely want to bounce back from a really, really bad loss to Paul Pustivar tonight.
Casey 2-2. John Epping leading China right now, looking to go to 3-1. We're going to take a look over here at sheet E. Trevor Bono with the hammer, throwing red stones here, taking on Craig Brown. Brown leading 3-2.
Yeah, it looks like only the third rock of the end for Trevor Bono.
Third stones.
Third. No, third rock, as in this is the second's first rock. So they're appealing the guard.
Craig Brown, one of the two U.S. High-performance teams. Craig Brown with a big win last night over Jeff Stoughton. I'm sure you all were watching last night here on TSN.
Yeah, Craig getting a couple of breaks on some Stoughton misses, most particularly a heavy draw against four. Craig is yellow in that setup, and he leads by one. Last two ends have been blanked, so he's desperately trying to force Trevor Bono into taking one.
Looks like Colin Hodges is not getting enough screen time in his own game. He's going to step over into into the Brown Bono game here. That's what happens when you throw lead stones. Nobody gets to know who you are.
Nobody loves me.
You're just a sweeper, right?
That's right. Throw two, sweep six, and shut up.
Yeah. When you end up on TV, you don't get to see your stones.
Nope.
So Stoughton goes in. A little bit off center there. And deep again. Connor's just struggling a little bit with his placement of his first stone the last few ends.
Yep.
Carruthers
yep.
with the corner guard up. And now he's looking to put the second stone in the rings here. For Carruthers, I think he's pretty happy with the placement of those two red Stoughton stones.
Yeah, I don't think he's overly concerned about where they ended up. One is kind of just hanging on the back edge of the tee line, and they're both off center, so.
Those are stones he's going to be able to utilize later in this end.
Absolutely.
He has lots of room to use this corner guard draw around. So, you know, for our new curling fans out here, you know, you might wonder why Carruthers is not hitting those two red stones. Now, what he's trying to do here with the hammer, the whole intent is your last stone, you have a point in your hand, is how they would say it. So what you're trying to do, and this is what Carruthers is trying to do here, is set up a second or third counting point so that when he has that last rock, he can make a shot. And in this situation, for example, that shot might be a double of those two red stones if everything stayed the way it is now to score his 2 points.
Yeah, the operative thought there is that you don't need to be shot rock on every shot. You only need to be shot rock at the end.
Exactly.
And this peel crosses the face, makes it the hard way. Alex a little bit miffed at himself. He makes the shot, but that wasn't the way it was called.
Yeah, when you look at peeling on the wrong side, you're really missing by, you know, 5-6 inches
yeah.
in the shot.
So. Yeah, he was significantly tight. Jeff called for sweeping right away, but he got away with one there.
So in the same situation here, Carruthers, again, going to be patient. He wants to keep protecting that stone on the side there. And he's going to do what you would call, you kind of waste some shots over here. Carruthers will throw up the center guard. You'll see Stoughton call for the peel again. And all he's doing is biding his time until he can make a move on those two stones in the rings.
Yep. Yeah, it's he really, really wants to get to this end and tie it up. He doesn't want to be forced to one and get Stoughton the hammer with the lead.
Exactly. And with Stoughton, you're not going to likely see him do anything too crazy either, for the reason that if he was to make some sort of a draw around that guard, or if he, you know, tried even trying the run back, for example, you give a chance where if you get a little bit of a mistake there, you might give up three here.
Exactly.
And Stoughton with a 2-point lead, he'd be content to give Carruthers 2 points here.
Yep.
But he certainly doesn't want to turn that two into a three.
Right.
So you see that they just peel this straight off. You'll see Carruthers throw that corner guard up again.
Probably a couple more times. I don't imagine he'll make a move in the house until at least one of Braden Muscali's shots, probably maybe Braden's last.
This is pretty textbook corner guard play here when the team trails by a couple points. And it's kind of this thing that I think the game is going to see some changes in the near future. The Grand Slams have been experimenting with the five-rock rule. And in this situation, for example, this is when the five-rock rule really makes a difference. So that first corner guard that Carruthers had thrown up would not have been allowed to be peeled.
Right.
So then what would happen is Stoughton would have to either throw a guard on his two in the house or make some sort of a draw around the corner guard. And then what happens is it brings bigger point ends into play.
Absolutely.
Late in games in this situation.
Yeah, it definitely makes you think a little bit. Wouldn't think that one extra rock and free guard zone would make a difference, but at this level it makes all the difference.
Yeah, it really doesn't change the game much until you get to a situation like this.
Right.
And then it dramatically changes the strategy and game calls that you need to make in this spot.
I know early on when they first started experimenting with the Grand Slams, they asked Glenn Howard his thoughts about it, and his basic response was it's a changer of certain situations, and it may turn the best defense into a good offense.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah, you look at Howard, he's always been a bit of him and his brother were kind of pioneers of the game, and the Moncton rule was brought into place. They were talking about that, and what the Moncton rule was when they were experimenting with it is that similar rules as the free guard zone, except no stones could be removed from play. So it doesn't matter where they were. It wasn't a rule that got implemented, but it was something that was experimented with pre-free guard zone days.
Right.
And the Howards, I believe, were part of that experiment and something that they had kind of brought as an option as well. And
right.
I believe they played an event with that where they toyed with that, and I believe that's why they called that the Moncton rule.
Right.
That'd be Moncton, New Brunswick, for all our American followers.
So Texas Curler is asking what we were just talking about, why peel the yellow guard versus posting a red guard to protect his two that are already in? And like we said, it's, Stoughton has the lead. He doesn't want to be throwing a guard when he doesn't really need to. Any tiny mistake gives Reid an advantage.
Chance
to score more than two. You know, Jeff is completely content to hold Reid to scoring two. If a guard isn't quite made correctly, or even if it is made correctly, Reid could play a freeze, he could play a tap, start building his own rocks up in the house.
Yeah. Right now, rocks in play for Team Carruthers are friends. It doesn't really matter what color they are.
Exactly. When you have a lead of 2 points or more, you generally do not want a lot of rocks in play, and that includes guards even on your own rocks, because those are rocks that actually help the opposition. And that's not something you really think about too much in league, but at this level, it is a continuous factor.
So here we go with Muscawi's first stone here of the sixth end.
They're
going to make the move.
It was just to jam and roll and sit second and third.
That's a great shot there. Rolls to the other side. Keeps lots of separation between the two yellow stones.
Yeah. And for those who might not understand, that the way that shot happened, that was exactly the call. The call was not to make the double. Wants to let it jam, roll second and third. Now he's got two in the house that are spread out and cannot be doubled. So,
if I roll here,
Jeff basically has to hit one of them.
Kind of an interesting situation here, I think.
Yeah, I don't mind that, Rob. Because we can almost nose this.
We have somebody asking, will you sometimes take out your own rock to limit the rocks in play? Absolutely. If it happens,
Especially if it's a poorly thrown stone in a bad spot.
Well, and Brian Anderson just posted peel of shame, and that's where if you are ahead a couple of points, maybe 2 points, 3 points, whatever, and you are throwing first and you throw it short instead of in the house, you will probably be asked to peel it off.
I think Brian has thrown a few of those in his day. We've got we couldn't get that on camera there, but looks like Reid Carruthers was putting in a drink order for his lead, Colin Hodgson. Margarita times two.
Give me a double.
Something, you know what, there's something great about this club, John Benton. Not sure what his title is, but he runs
the
place here.
He is the director of curling operations.
Director of curling. Yep. Gave me a tour of this place earlier yesterday, and you know, the bar service set up here is really well done. You know, something to continue giving the curlers some great hospitality. You know, you don't see it during this level of game, but for the club play, league play, the servers will actually bring drinks right down onto the ice for the curlers. The backboards is all set up. There's drink holders for each position, so that you don't mix up your drinks.
Yep.
And it's a great setup. I think any new club, even existing clubs, could take this setup and implement it in their own facilities.
The only slight knock of a comment that I've ever heard anybody say, is, and that comes from the folks that are more used to the traditional homey curling club feel, is that this feels a little bit less like a curling club. But it wasn't really designed to be that way. This is more of a curling center or a curling facility, if you will.
Yeah, it's more of an open concept. I think you see that a lot when you talk about curling clubs, and the name a lot of times will scare people away, thinking it's like a private facility and all that stuff, and
right.
People are not welcome to show up.
Yep.
And I think for 99% of the clubs out there, nothing could be further from the truth.
Mm-hmm.
And you're seeing that in a few places where clubs are actually renaming themselves for that exact reason. So
absolutely.
You're looking at, I think Charlottetown, Prince Edward Island is now the Curling Complex. And Moncton, New Brunswick does something similar as well with their facility. They've named it differently. And I think it just becomes a little bit more of a welcoming message to the people in the area.
Yeah, because, you know, there is no curling club in the country, with the possible exception of the packed to the gills St. Paul Curling Club, maybe, that does not want to recruit new members. They all want to recruit new members and grow the sport.
And even a club like St. Paul, you're looking at there's always going to be regular turnover.
Exactly.
You know, players
now with this facility here.
Give it up, yep. You know, I've seen clubs before where you've got 800 to 1,000 members and they're full, and the good ones continue to recruit even when they're full.
Right.
You know, they want to make sure that they're always having a crop of new members ready to fill in when people retire, move away,
yep.
For any number of reasons.
So somebody posted a question for me asking me, who are some former teammates or opponents who helped to shape my game the most? That's deep. I'm going to have to give that one a little bit of thought. So thanks for whoever asked that. You have got to make me think a little bit. Jeff makes the hit, but rolls the wrong way.
If you want to, go for it. Love to see it.
Yeah, I think just a hair.
And
there.
You're going to get it running straight?
Yeah. Like.
So
you just have to squirt it out of the 8 foot, right?
Yeah, just do that.
Yep. Great point that Reid just made there. You do need to move both of these rocks, but the operative point is that you need to look at where your third shot is on the right. It's in the 12 foot. So you only need to move the rock that's tough to remove, which is the top one. You only need to move it just out of the 8 foot. You only need to move it, say, 3 feet to the left. So you don't need to throw an absolute smoke bomb at this.
If this stone would have been right in front of it or flipped, where the top stone was that much on the inside, it would have made scoring two a lot more difficult here,
yes,
for Carruthers.
Much harder. Because if it's right in front of it, the only way you make the double, your shooter is going to be flying out of the rings all day.
This is certainly no gimme either. You know, he has to be careful. He hits this thick enough that his shooter doesn't roll out.
Yeah.
But then, in the right spot that he'll actually get that both red stones out of the 8 foot.
Right. The way Braden talked about it before he slid down was you're basically playing it like you're hitting and rolling to the other side of the button. And with the appropriate weight, that should squeeze the rock far enough out into the 12 foot to score the two.
Yeah,
This is, looks like it's over curling. It's gonna it's a hit, and that's gonna go in as a steal of one for Stoughton. Reid is looking back like it picked or took a hard jump out of his hand. I didn't actually see what happened, but not the result that he wanted. So that's gonna go in the books as a steal of one for Jeff Stoughton. That will put him up by a score of 5-2 with two ends remaining. So we're going to take a quick look over at sheet E for the last couple of shots between Trevor Bonneau and Craig Brown. And Craig is in some trouble. That is Trevor lying three behind the center guard.
Looks like Team Carruthers trying to put in a drink order there. Boy. Been a bit of that kind of game for them
First
here
it was
today.
Margaritas, and now it's something called a passion fruit spritzer. I don't think I even want to know what that is. I think we need to...
Only see Haji.
We need to educate this guy on some drinks, I tell you what.
Like pretty boy.
So last rock coming down the ice for Craig Brown. Looks like he's trying big weight, trying to make a double or possibly triple. Gets by the guard, makes a back double, which I think was the call. And so that is going to leave Trevor Bonneau a draw for two. So at worst, Craig will be down one with the hammer, playing the eighth end. We'll keep our eye on that sheet real quick. So as far as, I'll briefly answer the question now that I've had a minute to think about it. Influential curlers on my own career. Two of the most influential that I can think of would be a couple that I first saw play. I was pretty new to the game out at Potomac Curling Club, and that would be Derek Serka and Carissa Lynn. They played a mixed national championship in my third year there and didn't really fare that well, but I saw them and I was like, you know, I think I want to do that. That would be pretty cool. And a few years later, played mixed together, went to a few nationals, won a bronze medal, and they kind of inspired me to turn competitive. And as far as inspirations go, I think those two are pretty much at the top.
Yeah, Derek and Chris are now in Albuquerque, New Mexico.
Yeah, they don't curl anymore. They run. Yeah. They run marathons. So
when are you going to be inspired to do that in the near future?
Oh, God, no, I'm not a runner. So real quick, we're going to mention a couple more of the sponsors here of the U.S. Open of Curling. We've got Regan Moves. Regan Moves is a real-world effective diet and exercise program for people with chronic conditions. We've also got Gabe's Rinkside Bar and Grill, which is the Four Seasons Curling Club restaurant partner. They're open Monday through Friday, 11 a.m. to 1 a.m., and weekends from 10 a.m. to 1 a.m. They have a lot of really good food here. If you haven't come down and tried one of the paninos, you really need to, because they are tasty.
I would suggest bringing a friend, too.
You might want to bring a friend.
Those things are huge.
Oh, they're awesome. I had one for lunch, and I'm still not hungry.
I think we need more friends. I did the same.
Hey, they're good. What can you say?
And a flash peel here. Opens the door.
Yep. Only takes one airballed peel on double corners to maybe set up three. So Trevor Bonneau makes his draw for two. So Craig Brown will have the hammer down one in the eighth end. To the side. Actually makes the double. Rolls a little further than he wanted. Rolled in the open. But opens up the house, and Jeff kind of has to hit that one. gets it past the guard and rolls behind the corner. Probably not really where Stoughton wanted it, though, because that stone can now be frozen to. Looks like it must have hit a spot. It's taken extra rotation, and the way they reacted, it looked like it must have picked or fudged again.
Could turn out pretty good, though, at the end of the day.
Yeah, it's a bad spot. Almost gets in there for a second. Has a really good line. I see Stoughton peel the corner. You're going to peel the corner on the open side of the house.
I'm a little bit surprised to maybe see this.
I think he's doing this because he's still shot back there. He thinks in order for Reid to make anything happen, he has to make a play over there. Maybe he'll have a double. That's my theory.
Right,
do something like that. Oh my goodness. Kick it out in the open.
That's a pretty nice little bonus on there, getting that Yellowstone out into the open.
Oh, that's a sick bonus. No way do you ever call that. So Braden Muscawi was being asked to play the freeze. I guess the only thing about it is that it did actually kick the Brothers Rock into being shot stone, even though it is back 4 foot. Right off.
Again, we're in a similar situation here. Stoughton quite content giving up two here. Doesn't want to turn it into a three.
Absolutely. He can give up two all day.
Line's good. Line's good.
And he will have line's the hammer good. And the lead playing the eighth, which is a very strong position. Lines up in an almost identical spot, maybe about 4 inches deeper. So he has a decision. Could just hit the open one and sit two. So that's what he's having Rob Fowler do. Stay for Rob. Looks like he's only got about half a rock right now. Curls up and rolls a bit, but hangs on for shot stone. Talking about playing a tap on this, Braden was thinking just tap it frozen instead of throwing back four and actually moving the red. Reid wants to make sure he's second shot after this. Third shot, so he's at second. I wonder if there's an over-the-top double.
This is why I kind of wonder why Stoughton didn't
peel the guard.
Peel this guard.
Yeah.
Because now, because Carruthers can make the play, sit some stones under this guard and use this guard. The shot Jeff could have played on his previous shot with Fowler is he could have peeled the guard into the stone on the back of the forefoot.
Absolutely.
You kind of killed two birds with one stone.
Yep.
If you end up just peeling it off, that's fine.
That's fine, yep.
And then you got a chance to make a double somewhere. And, of course, Joe's showing us some arrows there, just a previous call. Now we're stuck here with a chance for, this shot here for Jeff's going to be a little bit tougher. He wants to try and hit a thin piece of this, probably a quarter stone across the top of the yellow. He can remove both yellows here if he hits this thin enough. I think he's happy to get rid of one of them.
Yep, he's going to try to get rid of both. Sweepers are on it right out of his hand.
Really going.
Gets one, gets two, kills the one behind it. But a really nice shot, actually. Gets rid of everything. Yeah, it's a nice bonus to get rid of that red stone back there because it was not helping him.
So Reed's going to use this corner guard here, try and draw one around.
Love the
and he's hoping to have a chance at a double on his last. Stoughton's probably going to make a draw somewhere if Reid buries this well enough.
Yeah. At this point, Jeff is pretty pleased. He will not give up more than two this end. About it picked again. I think maybe the middle must be getting a little flat. It's picked and stopped. Maybe losing the pebble a little bit on this line. Things not going the way of Reid Carruthers in the second half of this game.
Yeah, like he's gonna take one, so let's make it tough.
Jeff and Rob briefly talked about the best spot to put Stoughton's final rock. I think he wants to put it top 4 foot, maybe just a little bit in front of that other one. Make Reid have to make a double to score as one, or at the very least force a difficult draw. Foot looks like it's actually a little bit behind the tee line. Stop just behind the tee line. That
a little bit too deep kind of gives Carruthers a bit of a gimme here to get his point.
Yeah.
Play easy, give me edge of the rock.
Nose hit will get him the one. He's going to be in tough in the eighth. He's going to have to steal two to force an extra end. Nose hit for one.
Yep.
Looks pretty good.
Yep.
No mistake there. Reid Carruthers will pick up one. He's going to hand the hammer to Jeff Stoughton, and Stoughton will have a 2-point lead. And up in the upper left corner there, you can see they're showing you the eighth end of the Craig Brown-Trevor Bonneau game. This is Croy Nurnberger's first rock of the end.
Brown down one with the hammer.
Just drawn in to lay three, so he's in a pretty good spot right now.
Yeah, Bono's in some big trouble here. He does have a center guard out front, but you're looking at three brown yellow counters all lined up behind that guard. in our game, down two without the hammer. Reid Carruthers will throw up. He'll be looking for two center guards.
First guard goes up. Stoughton's going to ask Connor Nigavan to play the tick shot.
This is one situation in the game where I think you throw the tick shot a little bit differently.
How so?
The key here is you don't want to leave your other stone in play.
Yes.
Down two without the hammer. The team behind Carruthers. The whole intent in this end is you wanna lie three at the end of the end.
Mm-hmm.
So that when Stoughton is in the hack, throwing, he's facing a possible loss. Like in this situation here, you saw Carruthers sweeping that yellow stone. I'd rather, if he knows it's not likely to go out.
Just leave it.
Maybe. Then he has two corner guards to work with.
Yep.
Carruthers can throw up another center guard here. And now all of a sudden, he's actually got a great opportunity to lie three.
Because mm-hmm.
he'll go around the red one, Stoughton will peel that. Then he'll go around the yellow one. Stoughton will likely peel or hit, and you'll have a chance at some point to get three stones in the rings. And I've seen it happen on numerous occasions where, you know, it just changes your mentality a little bit.
Right.
All of a sudden, you go from feeling comfortable and calm, you know, you're in control. You sit in the hack for your last shot, and all of a sudden, that little bit of doubt creeps into your mind, and you say,
it's a little bit of pressure.
If I miss this, we lose.
Yep.
From feeling 100% comfortable and in control to just even that little seed of doubt. And
right.
And you see it happen where a team will hit and roll out. They'll call weird shots just for the reason that, you know, they don't want to lose.
And right.
You know, a lot of times in that situation, you know, Skip is left with a draw to the 8 foot for the win. Or a hit on a stone in the 4 foot facing three. And you'll see them play the hit to make sure they don't lose when, you know, they roll out there, they're going to have a much tougher shot in the
exactly.
extra end for
yep.
the win than right. just a draw to the 8 foot.
Yep. We just saw a little mistake there from Connor Negovan. Jeff called for him to peel his own rock. Not really a peel of shame in this circumstance. It's just a peel that he can make on his own rock, and Connor actually slid right by it. So number of rocks out in front for Reid to use.
Couple mistakes here, and Reid should, by the end of this end, he should have three lying in the rings. And then we'll see what happens.
So, Craig Brown sitting three and throwing. So Trevor Bonneau in some serious trouble, but this
thing's going to be, this is
gonna
a
be
rocket.
Through. Yeah, it's through. A little strong there from Croy.
Even still, I think for Bono, the best he's got is a double.
Double and off the top two.
Yeah, so I think if you're Bono, you may actually be considering some sort of a soft shot here. You're looking at the tap. You could even throw the draw around back of the 4 foot. Try and lie second shot in there somewhere. Force Brown to have to chase you, and then you might have the opportunity to get a force in this end.
Yeah, it's we're down to Skip Rocks, and he definitely needs to make something happen. Center guard goes away. Reid is going to draw around that guard that Connor Negavan flashed on. It's in there and sits two. I think you may see Stoughton either hit the open one, or he could peel the red in the direction of it. He's going to opt to play the open hit. He can make a double on these as well. It's fairly thin, maybe a quarter to a third. Now we have a handshakes on sheet C.
We'll get you a score update there once we know for sure, but it looks like John Epping victorious over Team China.
Yeah, and we had Brady Clark closed out a 7-3 win over Dunham. Looks like he stole two in the seventh. On sheet A, it was Mickey Lismore taking four in the seventh against Corey Dropkin, so he now has a three-point lead. With one end, they are playing the eighth. So the double was just missed by Alex Forrest. Reid is going to split the house. So it'll go in the books as a 5-4 win for John Epping. China taking one, but not enough, needing two to tie. So Trevor Bonneau makes a double on his first and rolls his shooter away. Craig Brown has a open hit to lie two. Rob Fowler's first shot of the eighth end is coming in. Makes a hit on the Carruthers rock. Rolls into the forefoot, so well executed. First rock of the eighth is coming into view on the bottom right. Hits and rolls behind. Don't know if that was the call. That's going to leave another double for Trevor Bonneau to at least force an extra end. We will keep our eyes on that.
Key shot here. One way or the other, I think this is probably the shot for the game. Makes this, he'll have hammer in the extra end,
yep.
And the opportunity to win in the extra. On a miss, obviously, Brown will be able to
draw for two,
just fully into the ring. So,
Rock is coming down now. Sweepers are on it. Get off. Must be close. Makes the double, no problem. Craig not happy. Has to draw for one. Try to win it in the extra. Rob Fowler's second shot. Makes the hit. Rolls. Sits two. That's a pretty good shot.
Looks like we have four stones to go. Producer Joe passing a little note there.
Its content will remain secret.
Like for Carruthers, there's a couple options here. I think he needs to get rid of one of these two red stones to try and lie three at the end. Let's just see on the other sheet there. Craig Brown, the draw to tie the game, and they're going extra ends. And we'll be going over to that game after we're done here with our feature game. So stay tuned, everyone. Looking like an exciting finish here at the U.S. Open of Curling.
Reed's initial thought was to hit this and roll to the left as we're looking at it and try and get another one hidden under that red guard. I'm not sure if that's what he's settled on. Based on the ice, I would imagine that's what he's playing.
I think he kind of has to play this shot at this point.
Yeah.
The other option that he could have here is the hit and roll in front of the other side or some sort of a freeze The problem with that is there's only two yellow stones remaining. He needs his two rocks to count, and ideally keep one of the other ones lying in the rings as well.
This is really curling, though.
All right, guys.
Yeah, that's taking off on him.
I don't think he's going to get much of a roll on it. Makes the hit, but
not far enough.
Nope.
Looks like that's probably going to leave a possible double as well.
Yeah, if Jeff wishes to take a rip at it, he can. He could also just nose hit, and then I'm not really sure how Reed's going to lie too at that point.
Yeah, nose hit here. It'll be a little bit in front of the other yellow stone, and the thin double I don't think is possible.
Nose hit is pretty much going to win the game. And we believe we'll very likely punch Stoughton's playoff ticket. He'll have a 3-2 record, but he's got an excellent shootout score.
Really comes down to what his number was posted here. So we'll keep you up to date once we have a little bit more information on that.
Obviously, playoff matchups are not going to be known until after the final draw tonight. And we will update what we can when we can. Stoughton's first shot coming into play. Hits and rolls back towards the middle. So
a double to lie two.
Did leave a double to lie two. Going to make Stoughton throw his last, but you have to make this first.
So for anyone looking for more information on the shootout scores, they are on the scoreboard on curlingzone.com. You just click on the event, go into the event page. You find it in the scoreboard of events on the right-hand side. There's a little link there for the shootout rankings. So yeah, right now,
Stoughton is way up there. He's it's not as good as I thought it was. But
so yeah, he threw an 18 and a quarter in this last game, so it dropped him down a bit.
Well, the worst one's going to get thrown out though.
Yeah. So he's currently sitting sixth overall with 24 and a quarter inches total. Teams like McCormick, Curry, Adam Casey, Steve Laycock, and Mike Farbelow in front of him. So I think he's looking pretty safe for a playoff spot, but lots to shake out yet here, too.
So Ryan doesn't make the double, jams it. That'll be the end of the game.
That'll be a single point for Team Stoughton there. He'll win 6-3, improve his record to 3-2. Carruthers drops to 4-1. And get a little bit of rest in before tomorrow morning's quarterfinals matchup.
Yeah, it's entirely possible these two teams might meet again. Well, I mean, Stoughton has to wait and see what happens, but he's got a good enough ranking that he is probably going to be in. So we're going to turn our attention now to the game between Craig Brown and Trevor Bonneau, the extra end.
First, by the looks of it.
A couple rocks to go over in the Dropkin Lismore game. Dropkin needs to get three to tie. He is currently sitting second shot, back corner of the 8 foot at about 4 o'clock. Lismore is shot, biting back 4 foot in the middle, and also third, way over about 3 o'clock, just hanging on the house. There's really not much else in play of consequence. There is a corner guard way off to the other side.
Center guard up here for Craig Brown. Jordan Potts looking to peel it off. I believe that's
might be a little bit wide. This is the peel. Gets the one in the house.
That center guard is quite high right now. So, I think that peel is not a bad result at the end of the day, getting the one in the house. You're going to see Craig Brown here actually draw around that long guard and try and set up a better tight center guard here. So it's kind of a draw around the guard.
Right.
We're into the end here. Into second stones, Jared Zezel. Throwing second stones for Team Brown.
Corey Dropkin's first shot over there on sheet A drifted to just back tee line. His two rocks are very close together. Nick Lismore just needs to eliminate one, and he will pick up the win.
Trevor Bono and Craig Brown do have a bit of history, last facing each other in the Curl Misabi Classic last season. Bono winning 7-2 there. Previous to that, 2011, the Coors Light Cashbeal in Duluth. Craig Brown winning, and then way back in 2007 at the Madison Curling Classic, Brown winning there as well.
It was called the Morgan Stanley Curling Classic that day. So the hit is made by Lismore on sheet A, and he picks up the win over Corey Dropkin. Final score of that will be 8-5. Craig is going to continue to establish the center guard as long as he can. Troy Nurnberger is throwing his first rock. Oh, maybe he's coming around now. Yeah, my mistake, calling the come around. Troy gets by with not a lot of room. He's drifting behind the tee line and out the other side. But it settles into the back of the forefoot. Trevor correctly calls for the peel. Drifts into the house. Corey Carr back playing after taking the game off earlier today. He's going to take a run at this double. Nose and makes a nice double. So I think Craig will be looking to come around that red stone that's sitting there. I think BA has gotten the eat yet, actually.
On this ice, that rock top of the 12 foot is still in a great position. That is a good guard.
Yes, it is. Very usable for Craig, which is why he's going to go around it. Operative point here is to make sure he's buried.
Yeah, he
wants even be a little bit deep. You like to be in front of the tee line.
He wants to put this in a place where it can be the winning point.
This has got to get by. Just wreck.
Now again, you look at this shot here. You know, if you're Bono, do you ever consider just peeling this out?
Absolutely.
Right now, I think he's looking at the nose hit.
Thank you. Trevor Bonneau's first rock. Makes the nose hit, just like he called. That's Craig will be playing the same shot no matter what. Now he's going to try to draw on the out turn side.
Final game here on the ice on, where we draw number 7 here this weekend.
Yep, one more round robin draw tonight and then playoffs tomorrow.
So tonight's game, we've got John Epping, Toronto, Ontario, taking on Adam Casey, Charlottetown, Prince Edward Island.
That should be a dandy.
Epping currently 3-1, looking to get to 4-1 and clinch his playoff spot. Adam Casey, 2-2 right now. They will need a win tonight to get into the playoffs. And then need a little bit of help as well, as shootout scores will break ties among the 3-2 teams.
I believe Casey has a really good shootout score, so if he wins, he has a pretty good shot of making the playoffs, depending on how many two-loss teams will get in. We won't know that until the conclusion of the draw tonight. So Craig Brown's final stone of this extra end is underway. Has to get to shot stone. Sweepers have taken this most of the way down the sheet. Corey is running out to help.
To get this one by,
get
it can
it
be a
by.
Good one.
Gets it part buried. Some fantastic sweeping there to get that by.
Right onto the back of the button. In this situation, I like the placement there, actually. You know, they could have left it a little bit shorter, try and sit on the button or bite the top of the button. But now what they do is they leave two shots for Bono, even three shots.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's got the little slash run back here. He's got the long run back. Or he could throw the draw and follow him down and sit one. And,
nope.
And for Craig, by sitting where he did, he actually puts a couple different shots in his head. And by going this deep, he does make this run back just slightly more difficult, adding
like
a little bit more distance between the two stones.
Trevor has elected to play the slash and
slash run back, same
slash
thing.
Slash run back. I personally think this might be not the easiest choice he has.
I think it comes down to knowing a piece of ice.
Yes.
You know where he knows where to put the broom here.
Yep.
Feels comfortable in this spot, and we'll see final stone here, extra end. Sweeper's really working on this one.
Looks like it's pretty close. Gets it.
Quarter stone.
Kills it. Beautiful shot.
Single point.
And Trevor Bonneau picks up the win. And that is going to conclude our coverage from draw number 7 at the U.S. Open of Curling. We will see you at 9 o'clock. We'll be having John Epping versus Adam Casey. So for Jerry Gertz, Joe Calabrese, and Brian Anderson, this is Sean Murray signing off from the Four Seasons Curling Club in Blaine, Minnesota. And we'll see you in a little bit for the last round robin draw.